600 subscribers. Wow. You know, it was only about 5 or 6 months ago that I found out that I'd reached 500, which for me was a pretty big milestone. But, you know, ever since then, for some reason, it seems like my fan base has been growing, and not just that, but growing steadily, and a lot faster than it was before. 3 months ago, I announced I was making this video for my 600 sub special, and in the intervening time between then and now, I've gained about 50 more. I don't know whether that's a sign that I'm getting more popular, or that I have less and less time to make extra videos when I'm making weekly reviews most of the time. Either way, though, I'd like to take a moment to thank all of the people who chose to subscribe, and I'm glad that you like my videos enough to stick around and see more of them, whether you're laughing with me or at me. However, I made a promise when I reached 500 subs, and that's a promise I intend to keep, to go back to a review that I made for my previous channel and make it even better. I'm the Hero of Tomorrow, and today we're taking another look at The World Ends With You. I fucking love this game. I love it so much that in the past I tried to do what Dina did for the Silent Hill series, going into a huge in-depth retrospective of the game. Unfortunately, that didn't work out very well in my opinion, because at the time I was still rough around the edges when it came to reviewing. Oh, don't get me wrong, I still am. I've just gotten a little bit better since then. By about this much. But I do know one thing. I can't just give this game a straightforward review. That, to me, just isn't enough. But if I spoil the whole game for you, then some of you won't want to play it. So here's what I'm gonna do. Like last time, I'm gonna do a long retrospective of the game, covering it pretty much all the way through and everything I like about it. But before I do that, I'm going to do an Art of Gaming style review of The World Ends With You, so that those of you who haven't played it can get an idea of just why I like it as much as I do. So no more stalling. Let's get things started. Square has a rather infamous way of writing protagonists. Well, at least once they got more than 16 bits to work with. People like Spoonie have made fun of Final Fantasy's idiotic protagonists for a reason. Most of the modern ones suck. But even if they do make dumb decisions, I just can't hate Square. They still gave us some great games with memorable characters like Final Fantasy IV and VI, Chrono Trigger, and yes, even Kingdom Hearts. And despite me wishing they'd bring back Geno for a future Smash Brothers game, Square and Nintendo are still making great games. Case in point, The World Ends With You. But a funny thing about this game is, in a lot of respects, I think Square is actually kind of making fun of themselves with this, or at least trying to do something new based off what they've done before. That's evident from when you first meet the main character, Neku Sakuraba.
Out of my face! You're blocking my view! Shut up! Stop talking! Just go the hell away! All the world needs is me. I got my values. So you can keep yours, alright? I don't get people. Never have, never will.
Certainly a far cry from... Okay, I'm not playing that again. Neku's a bit of a loner, as you can see, which is why he's pretty upset when he wakes up one day in the middle of the scramble crossing of Shibuya. From what I gather, Shibuya is actually a big commercial district in Japan. There are a lot of malls, restaurants, and even a few record stores. It's basically the kind of claustrophobic place that Neku would call hell. And I mean that in more ways than one. He discovers a mysterious pin, like this one, and starts messing with it, but he accidentally ends up activating it and starting to hear the thoughts of everyone around him. Yes, they gave the introverted person the ability to read minds. The person behind this is a dick. All of a sudden, a message appears on his phone telling him to reach the nearby Mall 104, which is a paper-thin knockoff of real-life Shibuya Mall 109. It even looks like it in the game's text. A timer suddenly appears on his hand, and mysterious symbols appear with monsters coming out of them. Neku tries to call out for help, but nobody seems to hear him. And then the game's actual opening begins. Now, I don't know about you, but when I played this game, I was immediately hooked by how quickly they established the situation and made it an intense one. Oh, and this opening? Yeah, you would never know this the first time playing, but it foreshadows pretty much everything that happens in the game. But it goes by so fast, you'd have to be paying really close attention even if this wasn't your first time playing to make the connections. Speaking of connections, Neku learns that he is now a player in something called the Reaper's Game. And in order to stop the creatures, called Noise, he has to make a contract with another player to take them down together. And the Noise are basically the Heartless of this game. No, really. We learn later on that the Noise are created from two different sources. The negativity in people's hearts, and the Reapers artificially can create them by binding a piece of soul to a pin. So yeah, they're basically normal Heartless and Emblem Heartless. Although I do think that's a pretty creative way of explaining why the enemies drop items. Oh, and speaking of pins, you may be wondering what's up with all of the pins if you haven't played the game. Well, it turns out that you don't fight the Noise with magic, but rather with psychic powers called Psykes. These powers manifest themselves in the form of collectible pins which you carry into battle. And since Neku is the main character, he can pretty much use every pin in the game where all of his partners can only use a few. And it's not just battling. Everything in this game is done with pins. Item crafting, getting money, all of that is done by exchanging pins. There's even a minigame called 10-Pin Slammer, which becomes important in later story missions. And I suppose you could call that a bit insane, but really, I'm kind of glad. It makes inventory management a lot easier. Although, you still have food and clothing items to buy, but I'll get to that later. Neku, desperate for help, decides against his better judgment to make a contract with Shiki Mizaki, a girl who looks like your typical Shibuya fashion slave, but is hiding a dark secret. And it's here where we find out the reason why there needs to be two-player teams. The Noise exist on two different planes at once, and you have to destroy them on both of them to stop them completely. And of course, by two different planes, they mean the top and bottom screens. And it's in this regard that I really have to give it to this game. Why? Well, think about this. When the DS first came out, did you ever once think, "Oh my god, two screens! I'm sure that'll make for great gameplay ideas!" If you said yes, you're lying. But even if Nintendo have made some mistakes in the past, in the modern age, they seem to be proving that they're crazy like a fox when it comes to new gameplay ideas. This game is a prime example of that. To stop the Noise in battle mode, you control Neku on the bottom screen using the stylus, and his partner on the top screen using the D-pad. Or, if you're left-handed, the four face buttons work as well. This is a very good battle system. True, it does require you having good reflexes to pay attention to what's going on both screens and act accordingly, but it makes use of both screens effectively, and once you train with it, erasing the Noise is going to be second nature. Until you get to the elephants, and the wyverns, and the bosses, and the pigs, and don't get me started on the taboo Noise. Oh, and did I mention, you have to do well in time and damage if you want to get the pin that drops on each difficulty. Except for the pigs. They drop the same pin no matter what difficulty you're on. Well, okay, you can hedge your bets in a few ways. The lower your level is when you beat a difficult Noise, the more likely you are to get a rare pin. And this is one of those games where you can adjust your level freely after a while. Though, of course, the lower your level is, the less HP you have. So you've really got to be a pro at the battle system if you're going to start grinding for rare pins that way. And even then, you still might get your ass kicked, especially on the higher difficulties. Though, thankfully, if you do screw up, you have the option to either escape or retry a fight on the easy difficulty. You can also adjust the difficulty of the encounters in the menu, but you're going to need to get stronger if you want to beat the Noise on hard or ultimate. That's where the equipment system comes in. Yes, like most RPGs, you can buy equipment for your characters that increase your stats. But instead of armor, it's just regular clothes. But here we see the true genius of setting this RPG in not just a modern city, but a modern city like Shibuya. As I mentioned, Shibuya is a commercial district, so naturally its residents are very fashion conscious. They're very sensitive to what's trending. Your characters also have a preference on what brand of clothes they like to wear and what foods they like to eat. You'll have to look up most of that or just learn it through trial and error, but the point is, if you use what works best with each character, they get an extra stat boost. Each pin also has a brand, and if your pin is trending, it gets a power boost during battles. But if it's not, then its power gets halved. However, it's easy enough to change the trends. Just battle wearing a brand of clothing or pin you want to trend, and it affects what's trending on the outside. But the question is, why can't the other people in Shibuya seem to see you or your partners? Well, that's easily answered. It's because you're dead. That is not a goddamn spoiler! I'm sorry, but if they were even listening when I was describing the premise that the game is run by a group of people called Reapers, that nobody can see the main player characters, or they saw the black skull motif of the player pin, then they would have pretty easily figured that out on their own, don't you think? So basically, all of the main characters are playing a sadistic game where the winners get a chance to come back to life. The Reapers are there to stop too many people from winning. Even though they can't attack players directly, at first, they can still summon noise to make sure that only the strongest player survives. Oh, and yes, you do encounter other player teams. There's Beat and Rhyme, who Neku rejects at first, but eventually finds himself becoming friends with them, as well as minor characters Sota and Nao. Most of the Reapers are also great characters, like the Team Rocket of the story, Uzuki and Karya, the food-obsessed Higashizawa, and the insane mathematician Sho Minamimoto, who I'm sure needs no introduction if you've already played the game. He seems to be the character that most people remember, and given the sheer insanity and awesomeness of some of his lines, it's not hard to see why. It's a pity that the game doesn't have voice acting other than the occasional voice grunt. Well, I suppose the characters at least have a few lines in Dream Drop Distance. But I won't go on for too long about the story, mainly because that's something you need to experience for yourself. Besides, The World Ends With You has far too many selling points to focus on just one. It also takes a fairly realistic approach to eating food to up your stats. You can only eat so much food before you're full for an entire day. In the real world. Yes, it takes a full 24 hours in real time for the characters to get an empty stomach again, which is represented by these 24 squares called bites. But fear not. Even if you do pig out the entire day, 6 bites will always be left open, so food that doesn't take a lot of effort to digest can still be eaten. Neku and his partner could literally chow down on ice cream and coffee all day if you wanted them to. Although, of course, the food that gives you the best stat boost takes more bites to digest, except for medicine. Well, that's until you get the sticker called Hollow Leg. Then you can pretty much eat what you want when you want. Oh yeah, the stickers. I forgot to mention those. You see this pin? It's called Scarletite. And let me tell you, by the end of this game, you're going to hate it. Why? Well, it's because Scarletite is among the rarest pins in the game to get. And of course, it's used to trade for stickers that upgrade your characters. You only get so many of them in the main story, usually from beating plot-related bosses. Now, there is a way to get more, but if anything, it's even worse. That involves this pin, Dark Matter. How do you get Dark Matter? Well, you have to trade it for 10 Shadow Matter. How do you get Shadow Matter? Well, the toughest noise in the game, drop it. Let me explain it this way. You see that light ring that keeps going from character to character in the footage I'm showing? That's called the light puck in this game, and it moves whenever you land a combo if you have the puck. So basically, if you keep the combos going, the puck goes back and forth, and if you keep the chain going, you can get up to a 5 times damage multiplier for whoever has the puck. Note that this also multiplies the power of healing pins. But then there are taboo noise, which I mentioned before. No matter how much of a multiplier you have going, you can only do any real damage if you have the light puck. Not to mention, they have a ton of attack and defense. And only the strongest taboo noise drops Shadow Matter. And that's on the higher difficulties. And for 10 Shadow Matter, you only get 1 Dark Matter. And after that, you still need 5 Tektite pins and 2 Orichalcum pins to get 1 Scarletite. Admittedly, the other 2 aren't as hard to get, but you're still going to be grinding for Shadow Matter a lot. And you know what's worse? In the post-game, you unlock a special optional store called Shadow Ramen that sells nothing but rare pins. How do you get those pins? Shadow Matter. Can you see why I don't like this pin? I've got a few tips, though. There are stickers that increase your offense and defense available. Trust me, those are the least of your priorities, and you often get them after story missions anyway. Most of the best stickers are found at a store called Shibukyu Heads, though other stores sell about 2 or 3 of them. Your priority should probably be the Hollow Leg sticker that can help with stat enhancement, and the stickers that unlock the higher difficulties like Ultimate. definitely get the extra slot stickers that allow Neko to carry extra pins in the battle. Yeah, you can actually carry up to 6 pins, and you're going to need all of them for the more difficult battles. After that, get the stickers that allow you to chain multiple noise battles. The more rounds you can last, the more likely you are to get rare pins. And I usually go for the fusion level stickers after that. Crap, I forgot to mention fusions. Yeah, fusions are basically your ace in the hole. See, if you can keep the combos going, sometimes you'll get a large pin that appears in the top right corner of the bottom screen. Touch that, and you get a super attack that hits all enemies on screen. These attacks can also be leveled up, but they don't just do a lot of damage, they also heal you. So yeah, getting fusions, pretty big priority. After that, then and only then do you go for the attack and defense pins. But by that point, you'll probably be running out of Scarlet-type pins anyway, since most of these stickers are only available in the post-game. But the game is pretty fair here. If you miss out on something during the story, during the post-game, you can go back to any day you want to. Hell, it even gets you some rare items. Grinding is grinding, though, so you're probably thinking you're going to be bored out of your mind when you're doing this. Well, you probably would be if you had the volume turned off. Oh yeah. If there's one thing that fans and haters of Square can agree on, it's that the company is known for making great music. And The World Ends With You is no exception. This is one of the few games I've reviewed where I'd actually recommend picking up the soundtrack. Or at least I would if it was still available on iTunes, which I don't think it is anymore. Fortunately, at least in this regard, Square were kind enough so that if you buy the music track in the game, you can listen to it anytime you want from your inventory. Hey, at least this way, Neko's headphones are good for something. And I'm not gonna argue if we've got music as good as this to listen to. Breaking some of those memories are scratching my nerves. And I am hearing their voice in deepest reverb. I've got to get out of this pain before I tame. Why can't you leave me alone for just one night? No matter how hard you pull me in, I know gravity ain't an excuse. I just wanna make things a little more smooth. Majority is still asleep, they're tired of those dreadful dreams. Now let me shout and wake you up, let me wake you up. It opened up without any indication. I thought I'd fall. Music I'd put on my iPod. It's not just good because it reflects the ambience of a scene in the game. It's damn good music in its own right. So far I've shown you a basic overview of the story, an outline of how creative the game can be with elements of its setting like fashion and food, shown that the game has a good battle system that keeps you on your toes, and that it has great music to listen to while you're battling. But if this review has convinced you that this game is worth playing and you want to check it out, then don't continue watching the rest of this review. Like I said, I'm going to be going through the rest of the game in the next few parts of this review, so unless you want the experience spoiled for you, and trust me, you don't, then you don't want to keep going until you play the game for yourself, because it's definitely worth it. However, until next time, this is the Hero of Tomorrow, and I bid you a fond farewell.